miles an hour, going fast as I can, trying to push a little harder, trying to get the upper hand. So much to do in so little time, it's a crazy life. It's ready, set, go, it's another wild day. When the stress is on the rise, in my heart I feel you say, just breathe, just breathe, come and rest at my feet.
Good morning. We want to welcome you to our Annandale Baptist Church Facebook page and our YouTube channel. We thank you for tuning in and joining with us as we worship our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And I want to begin this service by reading with you all from the book of James, chapter 1, verse 17. And with this, we're going to begin our worship service today. And this is what the Word of God says. Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadows. Our amazing, our wonderful God and our Father, we come before you, God. We thank you for all the wonderful things that you do in our lives. Father, we're so grateful in how you provide for us, how you protect us, how you guide us and lead us, and how your Spirit draws us closer to your heart. Father, we're grateful for the wonderful things, God, that you have given us. We know and believe that every good and perfect gift comes from you because of your great love for us. And God, we are most grateful for the wonderful gift of your Son, Jesus, who is our Lord and who is our Savior. And so, Father, we come together to worship you, to honor you, and to glorify your great name. We thank you for your presence here with us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus Christ, our Lord, in our risen Savior, we pray. Amen.
Your voice, your
love you, Father.
Darkness of Good morning. I want to welcome you to our service this morning. Thank you for praying for Annandale Baptist Church. We're continuing to go forward for the honor and the glory of the Lord. And this morning I'm reading from Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. This is what Paul says in these verses. He says here, "For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work his good pleasure." What a beautiful verse. The Lord is at work in us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are working in us, Lord. I thank you for that, Lord. I thank you that you want to help us to grow spiritually, to become like your Son. I pray that this morning we would understand your part in our spiritual growth, in the process of sanctification. I pray, Lord, that you would help us to apply your word to our lives. For I pray in Jesus' precious name, amen. So we're looking at Philippians chapter 2, verse 13 this morning. And Paul is sharing with the Philippians five realities of how God is working in their lives. We read verse 12, which said, here in chapter 2, verse 12. "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now how much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Remember last week we talked about our role in this process of sanctification or spiritual growth. The Lord wants us to grow spiritually. It's amazing how many Christians are still spiritually immature, babes in Christ. If they are saved, the Lord wants us to go on in our process, in the sanctification process of growing to become more and more like Christ, to grow in our spiritual lives. He doesn't want to have a church full of spiritual babies. He wants mature believers. Spiritually mature believers that are growing to become more and more like Christ. He's working in us. We're to work out our salvation. Remember, that's our part, to be available to the Lord, to be obedient, to be submissive to Him, to put into practice what His Word says. But that will never happen if we don't have His power and if He doesn't energize us to fulfill His purpose in and through our lives. And so that's what we want to look at this morning. How does the Lord work in us? And here in these verses, it gives us five realities that I want to share with you this morning. The first one is here that says, "For it is God," chapter 2, verse 13, there at the very beginning there. It says, "For it is God." You know, God is a person. The Bible describes him in human characteristics, but it's called anthropomorphic, human-like. You know, this is what they use. We know that he is beyond these things, as he has eyes, he has ears, he can, all these things that he can feel, he acts, he speaks. All these are part of his personhood. The Bible says that, and he's a personal God. The God of scriptures, Jehovah God, is a personal God. The other gods of other religions are impersonal. The people fear and they follow them and worship these false gods because they believe that those gods will give them benefits, will give them favors. Oh, I know so many people that follow false gods. And they believe that they need to do that, or else these false gods are not going to bring blessings to their lives. They're not going to bring faith. They're not going to give them favors, benefits. But this isn't the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible, the God of Scripture that has revealed Himself through His Son and through the Scriptures here, is a personal God. He loves us. He cares for us. He's concerned about us. Even right now in the time, this time of the coronavirus, COVID-19, He cares about us inside and out. This is the God that we have. That's what it says here in verse 13. For it is God. God is the one that's working in us, and it starts with Him. That's His desire for us. And the well-known verse in John 3:16 says there, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. And it says in verse 17, for God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. Might be saved through Him. It isn't God's will that everyone perish, but it's His desire and will that everyone would repent of their sins and turn to Him and seek Him and love Him. That's what the Lord wants. He wants to have close relationships with us, His children. He wants everyone to be saved. And when we are saved, when we give Him our lives, then we walk with Him. We have intimacy with Him. He blesses our lives. This is a wonderful reality that we see here in this scripture that Paul is talking to the believers and the church, and he's saying, for it is God. That's where he starts, with God. He loves us. He's a person. And he wants to be personal with us and have intimacy with us in this relationship. And then he goes on to say, the second reality there is that who is at work in you? He's at work in us. He's providing His power, providing His resources for us. This is what the Lord does. He wants us to be obedient to Him, obey Him. And He provides that power for us to be able to live out that holiness that He's calling us to live out, to be holy, because He's holy. We can't do that on our own strength, in our own power. We need His power. We need His strength to be separate from the world, to be distinct from the world, to be different from the world. We can't do that with our own power. We need for God to provide that power in and through our lives. And this is the second reality that he's sharing. Paul is sharing here with believers, with us. Who is at work in you? I thank the Lord that it's not, this Christian life is not lived out in our strength and in our power, but it's lived out in His power and in His strength. That's how it's done. And it's also by His grace, His favor. We don't even deserve to go to heaven. We don't even deserve His love. But out of His love, and by His grace, He provides grace not only to save us, but also to strengthen us. And that grace that we live out in the Christian life, by grace. And His word says that. That's Paul's secret. Paul learned the secret of how to live the Christian life, because he knew that the power was coming from God. He was making himself available. He would submit to God. He would obey God. And God would provide the power, the energy that Paul needed in life and we need in life. We can't live the Christian life apart from God's power or apart from God. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3:5, he says, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, he wrote, but our adequacy is from God. 2 Corinthians 3:5. He's the one that provides the power, the resources, and helps us to be adequate to live the Christian life. It is a gift of God. It is by His grace and by His power. And then in Ephesians 3, chapter 3, verses 7, 20, and 21, he says this. Okay, now to him who is able, okay, who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all the generations forever and ever. It's by his power. There it says that in verse 7. Working of his power, according to his power, for his glory and for his honor. And what about the Great Commission? You know, the Lord left us with the Great Commission. He said, do this in Matthew chapter 28, beginning with verse 18. He says that all authority and all power, he begins with that, all authority and power, authority, power, has been granted to me in heaven and on earth. And then he says, now what? Now go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. How do we fulfill that? How are we going to reach the world for Christ? It has to be through His power. How are we going to evangelize in our communities? It's by His power. That's the secret. We need to realize that and understand that it is God who is at work in us. God is at work in us. And even in Romans chapter 8, verses 31, 39, those beautiful verses there, the Lord talks about preserving us. Nothing will separate us from His love. The Lord is preserving us. We are held in His hands, according to John chapter 10, verses 27 and 28. We're in His care. We're in His power, in His hands. We're secure. We're saved. Nothing could take us out of the grip of His hands. His and His Son, Jesus Christ, double grip. Isn't that wonderful? The Word of God says that. We're in His hands, in His power, and it's by His power. And I want you to see the third reality about His presence. It says here, in you. Philippians 2:13. Here again, he says, for it is God who is at work in you. In you. Isn't that wonderful? The Lord dwells in us, lives in us. The moment that you believed in Christ, you trusted in Christ, you were saved, and He came to dwell in you. He lives in you. He lives in me. If you're a true believer, He is inside of us, and He understands us in and out. He understands what's in our minds, what's in our hearts. Psalms 139 says that He knows us thoroughly, totally, completely. Think about that. He lives within us. He resides within us. He dwells within us. And He says that apart from Him, we can't do anything. Apart from Him, we cannot do anything. In John 14, 16, He says, I will ask the Father and He will give you another helper, the Holy Spirit, Christ living in us. And he may be with you, that He may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, but it does not see Him or know Him, but you know Him, because He abides, He dwells in you and will be in you. See that? The Word of God says that He's in us. Acts 1:8. The Lord is in us. He dwells in us. His Holy Spirit is in us. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? This body belongs to the Lord. I need to be careful how I use this body. Does it bring glory to Him? Does it bring honor to Him? It is His temple. We are reminded again in 2 Corinthians 6:16. He dwells in us. He lives in us. His presence, He's with us. I will be with you always till the end of the age. Isn't that wonderful? I will be with you always till the end of the age. The Lord is with us. And so he works continually for our welfare, for our well-being. How can we not love the Lord with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our strength? How can we not serve him and love him completely? You know, Brother Tony Valencia, a good friend of mine, pastor from San Jose, a few days ago, he went on to be with the Lord. He had coronavirus, he had the coronavirus, COVID-19. And it seemed like he made it through that period, but he had some complications. And last week, his wife told me, communicated with me that he was improving. And this week, he went on to be with the Lord, 39 years old. We never know when our life is going to end. If you were to die today, do you know for certain that you're going to go to heaven, that you're going to go be with the Lord? If you can't answer that question, then you don't know. You don't know. You're not certain. Christ probably is not dwelling within you. You don't have Christ. You're not saved. And you need to get right with the Lord. You need to make sure. He was in the Lord's care. The Lord took care of him. The Lord watched over him. But that doesn't mean that one day we're all going to die. But we need to be prepared. You're never ready to live, as someone said, until you're ready, until you've made preparations and to die. Then you could live, because you know you're in the Lord's hands and you could go serve the Lord, just as Brother Tony did. He was helping people. He was ministering to people. But now he's with the Lord, which is our reward, which is what we all are all anticipating. And then the final thing here, just a couple of points more, his purpose. It says both to will and to work. Both to will and to work. See, we have to, that's talking about our will and our work for the Lord. Are you willing to work for the Lord, your will? Is it available to the Lord? Yes, I'm willing. Yes, I'm willing to read the Bible. I'm willing to serve God. I'm willing to do whatever the Lord says. Are you really seeking his purpose? If you're seeking his purpose, then you've got to put your will there for him to use your will. Yes, I'm willing. Here I am. What do you need? What do you want, Lord? And then, yes, I'll go to work for the Lord. I'll serve the Lord. Are you willing to do that? That's here, the will is talking that I'm making a choice. Yes, I will. I will do it. I'm making the choice to serve God. I'm making the choice to go to church. I'm making a choice to study the Bible. I'm making a choice to obey him. And then I put it into action. And what? And I fulfill God's purpose in me, his purpose in my life. But I have to be willing to serve him and to seek him. Am I willing to do that? Am I willing? You know, and what does this involve? It involves a couple of things here. First of all, that I always have this holy discontent, as some pastors have taught, holy discontent. I'm not satisfied yet. There's some individuals that think they've already arrived. I know the Bible. I don't need to study the Bible, read the Bible, and I already know everything about the Christian life. I've arrived. No one will ever arrive as a believer. Why do you think Paul said that? No, I continue on towards the mark, towards the goal. I leave what's behind and I pursue the goal. What? Becoming like Christ. And there's always this dissatisfaction with our lives. We have to have that dissatisfaction in our lives. Holy dissatisfaction. No, I can do better. I can serve the Lord in a greater way. I know. Look at what Isaiah said in chapter 6. He says, woe is me, for I am a man. I am a sinful man. Remember that? He was there before God, and he was recognizing and realizing his sinfulness before God. Are you conscious of your condition before the Lord? Your spiritual state before the Lord? We should be always desiring to grow spiritually. I know too many people that act like they've already arrived. That arrogance, that pride. But we need to be careful to examine ourselves honestly and carefully. Paul said, wretched man that I am, who will set me free from the body of death? He was always aware of his sin, aware of his shortcomings and faults in his life. That's how you live the Christian life. And then also, there's this aspiration, this desire, this holy aspiration that you want to seek the Lord. You want to live the Christian life. You want to seek righteousness. You want to be like Jesus Christ. Do you have that in your life? The desire to be like Christ? That, do you want to grow spiritually to be like the Lord? No, I already arrived. No, I've been a Christian 30 years, 40 years. You could be immature spiritually. You could still be a babe in Christ. Paul said, not that I have already obtained it or have already become perfect, but I press on so that I may lay hold of that for which I also I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That's becoming like Christ. This is godly will, godly work right here. The Greek word enerheo, which refers to what? Being energized. Enerheo means being energized. Having that power in your life that the Lord provides. What? To be able to live the Christian life. To be obedient. To fulfill the calling of the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? And then the final reality here is for His good pleasure. You know, it's all about pleasing God. It's all about doing the will of God. It's always about glorifying God. Paul says here, for His good pleasure, the Lord's pleasure, He delights in our faithfulness, in working in and through our life. It pleases Him. We are sinners saved by grace, and yet He chooses to use us and to work through our lives, and this brings pleasure to Him when we obey Him. Do you want to please God? Do you want to bring a pleasure to the Lord? This is what we find here. That God's great pleasure. That we be more and more like His Son. That we grow spiritually. It pleases God. I think if when we fulfill the Lord's purpose, it brings pleasure to His heart. How about when we disobey the Lord? How about when we choose not to bring glory to Him? I think that dishonors the Lord. It dishonors His name. The Lord grants us resources to accomplish the purpose that He has for our lives. And then when we accomplish the purpose, it brings pleasure to the Lord and it glorifies Him. If we would only turn from our sin and obey the Lord, we still fall short and have faults and sin, but we should immediately turn from that sin and obey the Lord. Confess that sin, as it says in 1 John 1:9, and continually be obeying the Lord. Don't stay down, but continually be obeying the Lord. The Bible says that He will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness in 1 John 1:9. And so, brothers and sisters, my challenge to you is this, that we would understand that the Lord is working in and through us, and that it's hard work to follow the Lord. Not to obtain salvation. We have salvation. But is there evidence in my life that I am saved? Is there evidence in my life that I belong to the Lord? As James says, that faith without works is dead. Am I serving the Lord for His glory? Not to gain eternal life. I have it already. But to bring glory to His life. To be a masterpiece for the Lord in my service for Him. As it says in Ephesians 2:10. Am I willing to give Him the credit? Give God the credit. It takes hard work. It's strenuous. But I have to be totally dependent upon God to fulfill His will in my life. Are you willing to do that this morning, my friend, my brother? Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and I pray that you would understand how God is working within you. It takes my cooperation with God, my obedience to the Lord, working out my salvation, but it takes His power through my life to live the Christian life. Are you living the Christian life? Are you living the life? Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, because this morning you've helped us to understand how you are working in us and through us, Lord. Help us to understand that you love us and desire the very best for us. You didn't call us to a life that is free of problems, difficulties, and trials. Those things will be there. That's part of the Christian life. But Lord, I pray that we would learn to trust in you, rely on you, depend on you, obey you, Lord, so that you would be able, Lord, to do that work that you need to do in and through us, Lord. I thank you that you live within us, Lord. Oh, Lord, help us to walk in unity as believers. Help us to walk in unity. And to depend on you fully. I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing within us. And I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you. We will see you next week. God bless. Thank you.
When it feels like surgery and it burns like third degree, and you wonder what is it worth, when your insides breaking in and you feel that ache again, and you wonder what's giving birth. If you could let the pain of the past go, of your soul, none of this is in your control. If you could.